Good to be in the house of God. Book of Exodus, chapter 14. I mean, Pastor Morrell did preach on Wednesday night. Sometimes you got to laugh. You know, don't be so serious all the time. Let's have joy of the Lord. Let's laugh a little bit. Exodus 14. Beginning at verse 11. And they said unto Moses, because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone. We're content where we are. Why don't you just leave us alone? That we may serve the Egyptians. We want to stay in bondage. So leave us alone. For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. Now, before you're seated, husbands, if you're beside your wife, I want you to take her by the hand. And, and say, you're the most beautiful thing I've ever seen in my life. Women do the same thing, but maybe put handsome in there or something. Now, for those of you whose spouse isn't here, close your eyes and do it. Just pretend. You may be seated in Jesus' name. One of the most powerful things known to man is the gospel. All right, let me stop right there and let me say here, right here, I'm going to rely on your response. And so I know that people say, when it's quiet, they're soaking it in. And I understand that. Why don't you soak a little bit of it in and then throw it right back at me just a little bit, all right? All right? Amen. Thank you. In Jesus' name. One of the most powerful things known to man is the gospel. After all, that's why Paul said that he is not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation. Without the gospel, we would have no hope. It's because of the gospel that we can have the opportunity to be saved. Now, you may ask, saved from what? The craziness of this world. That's in and of itself. Oh, my goodness. This world is crazy. Was it Brother Abernathy that said the other day, this is not the America that he grew up in. It's not the America that I grew up in either. It is crazy. This world is going crazy. You could be saved from all of that. Now, you're going to have to endure some of it, but you can be saved from it. You could be saved from sickness. Now, we have to endure that from time to time, but you can be saved from it. Disease, distresses, current hurts, disappointments, pain, family issues, struggles, and sin. Because of the power of the gospel, you can be set free from all of that. You have the opportunity here today because of the gospel. The gospel has the power to take all of this and put it into the past. Right? Amen. The gospel has the power to wipe all of this away and help you to stand before God clean. You know how it feels when you get all nasty and dirty and you come in and you're sweaty, whatever, and you jump in the shower, you take your bath, whatever, and you feel clean afterwards. Well, this gospel that I'm talking about can help your soul to feel that way. A refresh, a cleansing that you can stand before God with clean hands, a right spirit, and a renewed sense of purpose. Now, what is the gospel? Well, simply put, it is the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Because he died, we can live. Because he was buried, we can be saved. And because he was resurrected, we can have the Holy Ghost and we can go to heaven. Whoo! Aren't you thankful for that? Hallelujah. Now, the gospel, for those of you who may not know and understand this, this gospel is applied to our life by following Acts chapter 2 and verse 38. Then Peter said unto them, repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for the remission of your sins, and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. For this promise is unto you and to your children, to all them afar off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Amen. Now, let me stop right here and let me say this. If you have not heard this before, I'm here to tell you, this is the Bible. The denominational world will tell you all you have to do, need to do, is believe. Well, I will agree to a certain extent. You have to believe, no doubt about it. That's the bedrock of faith. So you have to believe, but then you have to repent of your sins. You have to be baptized in the lovely name of Jesus, and you have to be infilled with the Holy Ghost. Does anybody in the house still believe that? Come on, has it become such a mundane subject that we can't shout to that? Have you repented of your sins? Have you been washed in the name of Jesus? Have you received the Holy Ghost? Hallelujah. Aren't you thankful for it? Hallelujah, Jesus. And of course, how this applies to that, how Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection applies to Acts 2:38. His death is our repentance. His burial is our baptism in the name of Jesus for the remission of sins. And his resurrection is the infilling of the Holy Ghost. It all ties in perfect. And even from the beginning of time, there has always been types and shadows to point us to Jesus Christ. There's always been types and shadows to point us in the direction that Jesus is going to heal us. He's going to save us. He's going to die. He's going to hang on a cross. He's going to be buried in the grave, but then on that third day, he's going to rise from the grave. There's always been some type and some shadow throughout the Old Testament to let us know that. But the greatest of this one of these stories is, in my opinion, or one that we can draw a lot of application from today, is from the story of the children of Israel's deliverance from Egypt. Now, as many of you already know, and hang on with me, all you seasoned saints that already know this information, hang on with me. We're going to go somewhere in just a moment. Lay this foundation. Children of Israel were in bondage for 400 years. Moses was on the backside of a mountain, saw a burning bush. He said, go let my people go after 10 plagues. Pharaoh, let the people go, right? So they came out of Egypt, right? And now on their way, the part of the gospel I want to draw more attention to today is the burial aspect, right? And so as they're standing by the Red Sea, Pharaoh's army is on their back, as the Bible says, or as the song says, and they're standing in front of the Red Sea. They don't know where to go. And so God opens the water. He parts the water so they can go across on dry ground and be saved from Pharaoh's army. And in the story of the gospel, this is the equivalent of crossing the Red Sea. Is the burial aspect of the gospel. Come on, somebody. And so, it's safe to say the children of Israel were buried in baptism in the Red Sea. Now, what did this do? It saved them from the army of Pharaoh, right? But let's dig a little bit further. What did it do? Whenever they got to the other side, there was a clear, watery boundary line that separated them from their past. Thank God that they got to that Red Sea. Pharaoh's on their back. He opens the waters. They walk across through the water. And the water come closing in on Pharaoh, obliterating totally the armies of Pharaoh, getting rid of the children of Israel's past. Aren't you thankful? Aren't you thankful for that whenever you're buried in the lovely name of Jesus in that watery grave, that you can have your past obliterated and washed away? Come on, somebody, aren't you thankful that what you used to do doesn't remain on your account whenever you go through the waters of baptism? You can be set free from what you used to be. Hallelujah. Aren't you thankful you're not what you used to be? Hallelujah. I'm so very thankful for that water of separation, because I'm here to tell you, I think that the devil fights someone more frequently on the baptism situation than he does repentance. Because so many times we get this sorrowful feeling and we repent, and then how many times do we go back and do the exact same thing, right? We're guilty. We're all guilty of it. But I'm going to tell you right here, when you make up in your mind that you're going to get baptized in the name of Jesus, there's a covenant relationship that you enter in with Jesus Christ, and he takes care of all of your sin. The blood is applied. It's all washed away in the watery grave, and you don't have to face it no more. Aren't you thankful that you don't have to worry with that anymore? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Now, I'm going to read some scripture. I'm going to try to go through here pretty quick, so just hang on tight. Somebody grab a hold of your pew and hang on. All right, we're fixing to go. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning at verse 1, it says, "Moreover, brethren, I would not that ye should be ignorant how that all of our fathers were under the cloud." Now, this is New Testament. "And all passed through the Red Sea, and were all baptized unto Moses in the cloud and in the sea, and did all eat the same spiritual meat, and did all drink the same spiritual drink, for they drank of that spiritual rock that followed them, and that rock was Christ. But with many of them God was not well pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. Now these things were our examples." So we do need to pay attention to the Old Testament. "These things are our examples, to the intent we should not lust after evil things as they also lusted, neither be idolaters as were some of them. As it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and rose up to play. Neither let us commit fornication as some of them committed and fell in one day 23,000 people. Neither let us tempt Christ, as some of them also tempted and were destroyed of serpents." Whew. "Neither murmur." Say, "I ain't going to complain." Come on, say, "I ain't going to complain." "Neither murmur ye, as some of them also murmured and were destroyed of the destroyer. Now all these things happened unto them for examples, and they are written for our admonition, upon whom the ends of the world are come." Say, that's us. 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 21 says, this is specifically talking about Noah and his watery situation, "The like figure whereunto even baptism doth also now save us, not the putting away of the filth of the flesh, but the answer of a good conscience toward God by the resurrection of Jesus Christ." Romans chapter 6, "What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life." How many of you are walking in newness of life? "For if we have been planted together," another burial situation, "in the likeness of his death, we shall also be also in the likeness of his resurrection." Say, praise God. "Knowing this, that our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin. For he that is dead is freed from sin." Colossians chapter 2, buried with him in baptism, wherein also ye are risen with him through the faith of the operation of God, who hath raised him from the dead, and you being dead in your sins and the uncircumcision of your flesh hath he quickened together with him, having forgiven all trespasses. Thank God. Blotting out the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and took it out of the way, nailing it to the cross, and having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a show of them openly, triumphing over them in it. Colossians chapter 3, here it is, the last one. If ye then be risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sitteth on the right hand of God. Set your affections on things above, not on things of this earth, right? For ye are dead, and your life is hid with Christ. Set your affections on things above, not on things of this earth. And herein lies the problem that we find with the children of Israel. Every time they faced adversity or hardship, they thought the best thing to do was, let's go back to Egypt. And that became a problem. Now, if you've let go of the pew, I want you to grab a hold of the pew one more time, because we're fixing to go through some more scripture. Listen and hang on. Exodus chapter 14. First, give me some water. Exodus chapter 14. And they said unto Moses, listen to this. Because there were no graves in Egypt, hast thou taken us away to die in the wilderness? Wherefore hast thou dealt thus with us to carry us forth out of Egypt? Complaining, murmuring, is not this the word that we did tell thee in Egypt, saying, let us alone, leave us alone, that we may serve the Egyptians? We'd rather be in bondage than be right here where we are right now. For it had been better for us to serve the Egyptians than that we should die in the wilderness. Somebody say boo-hoo. Exodus chapter 16, and they took their journey from Elim, and all the congregation of the children of Israel came into the wilderness of Sin, which is between Elim and Sinai, on the 15th day of the second month after their departing out of the land of Egypt. And the whole congregation of the children of Israel murmured against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. And the children of Israel said unto them, here we go again, would to God we had died by the hand of the Lord in the land of Egypt. We'd rather died in sin than be right here. When we sat upon the flesh pots, and when we did eat bread to the full, for ye have brought us forth into this wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger. Exodus chapter 17, and all the congregation of the children of Israel journeyed from the wilderness of Sin. We're going along, right? Come on. After their journeys, according to the commandment of the Lord, and pitched in Rephidim, and there was no water for the people to drink. Wherefore the people did chide with Moses and said, give us water that we may drink. And Moses said unto them, why chide ye with me? Wherefore do ye tempt the Lord? You remember that scripture where it talked about tempting Jesus? And the people thirsted there for water. And the people murmured against Moses and said, wherefore is this that thou hast brought us up out of Egypt to kill us and our children, our cattle, with thirst? Numbers chapter 14. And all the congregation lifted up their voice and cried, and the people wept that night. And all the children of Israel murmured against Moses and against Aaron and the whole congregation, and said unto them, would God that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would God we had died in this wilderness? And wherefore hath the Lord brought us into this land to fall by the sword, that our wives and our children should be a prey? Were it not better for us to return into Egypt? And they said one to another, let us make a captain and let us return into Egypt. The last one, Numbers chapter 21, and they journeyed from Mount Or by the way of the Red Sea to compass the land of Edom. And the soul of the people was much discouraged because of the way. And the people spoke against God and against Moses. Wherefore have you brought us up out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? For there is no bread, neither is there any water. And our soul loatheth this light bread. We're getting sick and tired of these miracles right here. And the Lord sent fiery serpents. Remember that? Among the people. And they bit the people. And much people of Israel died. And so, here we go. So their distresses came in the form of protection, hunger, thirst, and leadership. They thought, standing at the Red Sea, they needed protection, and they thought it was better for them to be back in Egypt, right? Away from all of this. We don't want any confrontation. We don't want any to fight the Pharaoh and his army. So they thought it better. We just go back to Egypt. What's the big deal? They got in the wilderness and they got a little hungry. They got a lot hungry probably. And they began to say, hey, we should have just stayed in Egypt. We had a lot of meat to eat. We were in bondage, but we had a lot to eat then. They got thirsty. Same thing. We're thirsty. We want to go back to Egypt. And whenever they thought that Moses and Aaron couldn't lead them effectively, they said, let us make a captain that'll take us back to Egypt. Come on, somebody. As you can see, digging into their past finally got them into serious trouble. Digging into their past finally got them into serious trouble. Which leads me to my title. If you would, put that up. Saints with shovels will get in trouble. Brother Cheeto, you said you wanted to do it, so come here. Do not touch anybody with this or anything in this church, all right? Okay, so saints with shovels will get in trouble. Can I get an amen? When we face some of those same trials and tests, God forbid, that we desire to go back into Egypt. Let me say that again. When we face some of those same trials and tests, God forbid that we desire to go back to Egypt. Egypt, for those of you who may not know, is a type and shadow of the world. Once we've gone through the Red Sea, once we've been buried with him in baptism, we don't want to go back to the weak and beggarly elements of this world. There is nothing beyond the Red Sea that we need to go back to. There is nothing beyond the baptismal waters that we need to go back to. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody. Aren't you thankful that all of that's washed away? It would be like, if we did that, it would be like visiting the grave of our past and digging something up. Our past sins, hurts, lies, disappointments, distresses are supposed to be buried. Listen to me. They're supposed to be buried in an unmarked grave. Now, sometimes when we face death and we have loved ones that are buried, we go and we place them in a spot in a cemetery, and we put a headstone there, and we put their name on it, and an inscription there, beautiful scenery, beautiful set, so that when we do go back and visit, there will be a great commemoration to that person's life and to their legacy. Amen? But sin is not so. The old man is not so. Whenever you bury the old man, he's supposed to be buried in an unmarked grave. You're not supposed to go back and visit the grave of the old man. Come on, somebody. Hallelujah. We sometimes do visit our loved ones, but you're not supposed to go over and visit or mourn over your past. Can I get an amen? So we're not supposed to go back and mourn over our past, right? So, thank you. And so here we are on our Christian journey, right? I hope I don't get stuff on my suit. Here we are on our Christian journey, right? Well, saints with shovels will ultimately get in trouble, right? Because if you're carrying around a shovel in your walk with God with the intent of when trials come and tests come and everything gets so difficult, you know what? I think I'm just going to go back and visit that grave. I think I'm going to go back and visit that altar where I laid all of this down into that grave, and I think I'm going to start digging a little bit. I think I'm going to start poking a little bit and prodding, lifting up the dirt a little bit, because I know that God is good, and I know that He's delivered me, and He's set me free, but I'm going through something right now, and I'm thinking maybe it'd just be better to call it quits. I'm thinking maybe it'd just be better for me just to dig up that old man and set him up and prop him up and live my life like that. But saints with shovels will get in trouble. Let me tell you, there is a group of people in Indonesia that have a very unorthodox burial practice. And that is this. They have a festival that happens every 3 years. It doesn't matter if you've been in the ground 1 year. Doesn't matter if you've been in the ground for decades. Your family will come up and they will dig you up. And they will prop you up. And so here you are. Your stinking, decomposing body. And they're going to prop you up. And they're going to put you in some new clothes. And I even saw one picture where a guy was putting a cigarette in the mouth of the corpse. You know, there's a lot of pictures. I can't show them. They're too graphic and too grotesque. But can you imagine going and visiting your loved one? They died 30 years ago. Well, that's okay. We're going to go get them right back up. We're going to put them in the house. We're going to dress them up, put them in some new clothes. And in a lot of cases, they put them in new caskets or new burial vaults so that it would help thwart decomposition. Could you imagine? Could you imagine that being one of our burial practices? Now, they don't know any better. I don't fault them for that. That's what they do, but that's not going to come nigh my dwelling. I love my wife. If she should go by the way of the grave before I do, you're not going to catch me in the cemetery in the middle of the night with a shovel. I miss my wife, and I love her, but hey, you know what? Let the dead bury their dead, you know? I love you, honey. I'll see you from this side. I'll see you on the other side. See you in glory, right? I'll come and visit you now. Don't get me wrong. I'll come and visit your grave. But I'm not going to be digging you up. I've been involved, Brother Brad can attest, we've been involved with some disinterments in our lifetime. And I promise you, these disinterments never have gone very well. There's always some sort of something going on. And so, I wonder if sometimes we're like these Indonesian people. We use the old man as a crutch. Huh? When the pressure comes down upon us and the burdens of life get us down, do you revert back to the things you used to do? Do you revert back to the mindset that you used to have? I'm here to tell you, when the pressures of life get tough, I know that they're tough, and I know sometimes that you face problems, you face circumstances and situations You don't know how in the world it's going to work out. You wish there was another alternative for you than just to wait on the Lord. But sometimes you just got to wait on the Lord. And if you force this thing, then you're going to wind up going and getting your shovel. And you're going to wind up going and visiting the old grave, the grave of the old man, that you're not supposed to even know where it's at anyway. You just find it. You're going to search, and you're going to search, and you're going to look. And you're going to find that grave of the old man, and you're going to start digging. Well, I know life is tough, but maybe I should just pick that bottle up one more time. I know life is tough, but maybe I should pop that pill one more time. I know life is tough and things are going wrong, but maybe I should go visit that house of ill repute one more time. Or maybe I should get on my computer and take a look at illicit things one more time. I know things are tough, but maybe I should go grab that cigarette to ease my mind and to ease my nerves. Come on, ain't nobody in here like that, are we? Come on, let's be real. Come on. Come on, do you ever feel the need? I'm just telling you, you shouldn't be able to have to feel that need. But I'm telling you, some people, they do. They can't handle it. They can't handle the pressures of life. And so they go grab their shovel, and they start digging. Oh. Deliverance comes. And then on the other side of the Red Sea, when you face situations and you get hungry, you get thirsty, you get a little fearful, you start to wonder, you know, I never had to face this when I was in the world. I never fought this when I was in Egypt. You know what? I know this is a pretty tough situation I'm at, and man, I remember sitting by the flesh pots of Egypt, and we had food to eat. We were in bondage, but I'd rather be in bondage than be hungry. Yeah. And so instead of returning to the flesh pots of Egypt, you go back to the bar stools of this world, and you go back to the places of ill repute, and you go back to cussing, huh? You go back to doing things you know you ain't supposed to be doing. Because ain't no saint supposed to be carrying around a shovel. Come on, somebody. You ain't got no business carrying around a shovel. Oh, yeah. Praise God. We are not in the business of body snatching the old man. We don't dig up that rotting, decomposing past and redress it with some new clothes. Oh, we don't do that. Maybe I won't go down to Mama's Country Showcase, if that place is still open. I don't know. I hope to God it ain't. Maybe I'll, instead of going down to the bar and sitting right there on the bar stool, I'll dress this thing up with some new clothes and I'll just go visit the store. I'll go three counties over to the liquor store where nobody knows me, and I'll slide in there and I'll pick up that beer, pick up whatever. I'm telling you, you do that, you will find somebody you know, I promise you. Somebody, a saint of God, will be broke down in that parking lot, and they will see you coming out of that liquor store with a bottle of booze, I can promise you. Yeah. Maybe I'll sneak over here, you know, instead of going and visiting another woman or visiting another man, I'll just take a look and see on this internet right here. Nobody will ever know. You can't dress up the old man in new clothes. The dead is not supposed to be redressed. You dress them one time, and I know I don't mean to sound cruel and flippant, but when somebody dies, they're dead. We love them, we miss them, but they're dead. The old man, we're not supposed to love, we're not supposed to miss, we're not supposed to commemorate. We got to leave him buried. And so, saints with shovels will certainly get in trouble. We don't want to redress that thing. We don't want to spend some time with it. Well, it's just going to be for a moment. I'll get done with, I don't know why I keep talking about drinking. I don't know. I'll get done with this one can or this one bottle, whatever. And that'll be it. I'll bury that old man again. I'll lay him back down. I'll put that dirt back on him. The problem with that is, once you go back one time, you know where he's buried every time. You see, there's a beautiful aspect of this, your sins being buried in water, because have you ever seen something being dispersed in water? I mean, if it's a solid, then sure, you can find it, but eventually, all things go away. And whenever you ever put fish food in a fish tank, eventually it just disperses and goes away. Well, that's the way your sin is supposed to be. Your sin doesn't have any weight to it. Your sin doesn't, and this is not Bible, this is just, it disperses in water. Water is a perfect burial place for dispersion. But when you take that old man and you put him in the ground, and you try to find that grave again, you'll know exactly where it's at every time. And so once you go back one time, it's going to be easier to go back the next. And easier the next time. And then the next time, you're going to keep that old man propped up for longer than you thought. You're going to have one too many of those beers or that drink. You're going to have one too many of that marijuana. I don't even know what they're called. I don't know. Cocaine, crack, whatever. You won't just have one. You won't slip up and just have one. You'll do it more and more and more, and it'll become more frequent. Now, there's one more aspect we need to talk about. So, the point of all that is to say, you need to leave your old man buried. You need to not want to go back to the weak and beggarly elements of this world. But let's talk about one more aspect. And that is what I have affectionately deemed as apostolic grave robbers. These are people who take that shovel and try to dig up the past of others for gain or for advancement. Now, we know the story. We've heard our history. We know that there used to be grave robbers, certainly more prevalent then than what it is now. But all those grave robbers had in their mind was they didn't really care too much about being the body snatcher. They just wanted what was in that grave with that person. And I promise you, there's some people that bury some nice stuff with some people. Am I right, brother? I remember one time we were standing at the grave, and there was a biker gang, and they, his biker comrades was around, and they were dumping the dirt on there, and people were just throwing 20s in there, throwing $100 bills, and I'm like, oh, this is so sad. That is so sad. It's crazy. And there, and used to back in the 1700s and 1800s, and they used to just bury people in shallow graves. And they didn't really have to, the grave robbers didn't have to work very hard. All they really had to do was just kind of stand over in the shadows somewhere and wait for that person to be buried. And then wait for the right moment when everybody left them alone and slide over there with their shovel and start digging. It didn't take a lot of work, didn't take a lot of effort, but they dug. And God forbid that we be like that. There's some of you in here that know some past for other people. It's inevitable. You know it. You know what some of us used to be. You know what some of us used to do. And, I mean, hey, you probably were right there doing it with us, you know? But we should never get to the point to where we want to try to take advantage of somebody's past for our gain, whatever kind of gain or advancement that we think it'll bring us, and take our shovels and start digging into somebody else's grave. It don't matter what I used to do. It don't matter what I used to be. It don't matter what I got involved in back in the day. It's under the blood. It's beyond the Red Sea. I don't have to worry about that anymore, and I don't need you digging up in my past trying to dig something out. I want it to stay buried. You've heard many, many people, many preachers get up here and say, I'd be ashamed if you knew some of the things that I used to do. Well, that's because they want it to stay buried. They don't want it to be brought up. And so I ask today, are you guilty of being an apostolic grave robber? You know exactly what you're doing. You know what you're doing. You're standing off in the shadows somewhere while you see a saint of God, a newborn somebody doing the best that they can to serve God. They go down in Jesus' name. You see them at the altar. They're trying to get something buried. They don't want you to know about it. They're trying to get something buried under the blood. And here you are lurking in the shadows back there just trying to wait for the right moment so you can get in there and take your little shovel and dig into their grave and try to get something out that's going to benefit you. I'm telling you, if God don't like you digging in your own grave, imagine how he looks at you digging in somebody else's grave. The Bible says back in the Old Testament that anybody that touched a dead body was unclean. If you touched a dead animal, you were unclean for a day. If you touched a dead body, you were unclean for 7 days. I've touched so many in my lifetime that I'm probably just doomed. I need a lot of washing going on. I'm here to tell you, there's something about touching the dead. God don't want it. God don't want you touching dead things. And so I don't know if I got a revelation or if I'm halfway there, but I always thought it cruel whenever the guy came to Jesus and said, I want to serve you, but let me go bury my loved one. He said, let the dead bury the dead. Don't worry about that. I thought it was kind of cruel, but now I'm kind of getting a little bit of an idea. God don't want you touching dead things. He don't want you digging up the dead things of the past. He sure don't want you digging up somebody else's past. I don't know. I don't know if I have any Bible to back it up right now, but I just feel in my spirit that there's something certainly wrong with somebody that's willing to do that. If you've done that, shame on you. Ain't no saint supposed to have a shovel. But the good news is, if you're guilty of digging in your own grave, or if you're guilty of digging in somebody else's grave, you can put it under the blood. You can, one more time, get that thing buried in Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Woo! Thank you, Jesus. Isn't it amazing? How many times have you heard this? When somebody says, I've got some dirt on so-and-so. Where'd they get that dirt from? Digging at the grave of that person's past. If somebody comes to you and says, I got some dirt on somebody, you better run. You might want to pick up some dirt and throw it at them. Not literally. We have to be very, very mindful of what we do, how we conduct ourselves, how we act, what we get involved in, but we also have to be very, very conscious of how we treat others. I say this, and I mean it from the bottom of my heart. I will do the best that I can to not dig in anybody's past if you'll just promise to do the same for me. And I'm sure that everybody in here shares the same sentiments. And I want to tell you this. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter what kind of, you know, you heard people say, I'm not sharing gossip, I'm just giving a prayer request. Well, I don't think that's what you're doing. You are gossiping, you gossiper. And so I don't care what kind of good intentions you think you're doing. I don't care what good you think you're doing, or I don't know, maybe you think that what you're doing is appropriate and right. But I don't ever read anywhere in the scripture, anywhere, where there is something called the shovel of the Spirit. Have you ever read it, Sister Morrell? You ain't got no business taking a shovel and using it for the kingdom of God, or what you think is for the kingdom of God, whether it's for yourself or whether it's for somebody else. But there is something that I do read, and that is something called the sword of the Spirit. And so I think probably what we ought to do, and I'm preaching to myself just as much as I preach to you, I think what we ought to do is lay down our shovels, lay down your shovel of the Spirit, and pick up the sword of the Spirit. Instead of digging up the things of your past, wishing to go back to the weak and beggarly elements of this world, instead of trying to go back and doing the things that you used to do, grab a hold of your Bible and fight that thing. Don't give in to those whispers in your brain that tells you nobody loves you, or that you're not good enough, or that you're just a sum of all of your bad experiences. Look at those needle tracks in your arms. Look at those tattoos on your body. I don't care what the devil tries to tell you. You fight that thing. You don't get feeling sorry for yourself and go pick up a shovel and start digging. You pick up the sword of the Spirit and you start fighting that thing. Come on, somebody. Do I have any fighters, any warriors in the house today? Hallelujah. Come on, there is nothing in this world that you face that there's not an answer for right here in this book. Come on, it is the sword of the Spirit. It is the only defense that we have against this world. Everything else in the armor of God is offense: our shield, our breastplate, our helmet, our feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace, our loins girt about with truth, our everything. But we have a defense mechanism, and that is called the Word of God. And so whenever you get sitting around feeling sorry for yourself, or feeling like nobody loves you, or you get to hearing those whispers from the enemy or the flesh trying to tell you that you ought to just go back, because I'm going to tell you, you're not going to be able to go back through the Red Sea. You're going to have to go around it somehow. You're going to have to find somebody that's willing to take you over the Red Sea. And I don't know anybody in their right mind that's willing to take you over the blood, unless they have a shovel in their hand. And so I don't know how to end this thing. I'm done, but I don't know how to end it. I mean, a lot of people say that if you come up after message, then you come up to the altar, people know that you're guilty. Well, I say that's hogwash. I don't care if you're guilty or not guilty. I'll take... Had something hit me. People say life isn't fair. And that's true. But I thank God life isn't fair, because if life was fair, I should have been the one to die for my sins. If life was really, really, really fair, then it would have been me hanging on that cross instead of my Lord and Savior. And so I know life isn't fair, and I know that you get knocked down, and I know that troubles and trials come. And I know that if you walk down this aisle to an altar to come and make sure your calling and election is sure and to make sure everything's just right with you and the Lord, that there may be some people to say, hey, look at them going down the aisle there. But who cares? I don't care. Because you know what? Although, and I promise you, some of you are facing things that I've never, ever experienced. And so I'm not one to give you any advice on your situation, because there's a lot of you that have things going on that, oh, I'm so sorry. And I'm praying for you. But nothing that I could ever go through, Lord, nothing that I could ever go through should want me to desire to go back. We sing a song called I Won't Go Back. Once you've been touched, once you've been changed, once you've been healed, once you've been delivered from the crack house, once you've been delivered from the denominational teachings of this world, once you've been set free, it's a feeling like no other. Can you imagine how the children of Israel felt getting on the other side, looking back and watching waters, the walls of waters come crashing in on their past? My, what an imagery that is for our past. The devil knows that once you get beyond that water, he's lost you. And so that's why he fights you so hard. We ought to make it up in our mind. I'm not having a shovel. Because saints with shovels will get in trouble. But saints with swords will ultimately please the Lord. So it's up to you today. What do you want? You want to live your life with a shovel in your hand, constantly digging up the things of the past? Or do you want to just be set free, finally free from all of that? Why don't we all stand to our feet? And as we all begin to reach up our hands and feel after him one more time, I don't want to invite individuals to this altar. I want to invite the whole church to the altar. If you are so inclined to do so, you feel led of the Lord, why don't you slip out of your pew and come down to the altar? And why don't you make up in your mind, although things are tough and although things are distressing, I'm not going to reach for that shovel. Saints with shovels will get in trouble. Saints with swords will please the Lord. Jesus, thank you so much for your love and your mercy. How could we ever thank you enough just for one drop of blood that was shed on Calvary? Lord, your death, your burial, and your resurrection is the foundation of our salvation. Repentance, water baptism in Jesus' name, and the infilling of the Holy Ghost. God, help us to not desire the weak and beggarly elements of this world. Oh, God, we don't want to go back to the things, God, that we came from. Oh, God, deliver us from our shovels, God, so that we don't dig up our past. Set us free from being an apostolic reign. You're thankful that that you serve a merciful God. Of his mercy, he set me free. Why don't we raise our hands one more time and love him, thank him. If there's something that you've been meaning to tell him and you haven't told him quite yet, why don't you take this opportunity to whisper that word to him.
Not going back.
That message, how much it meant to me. I'm so thankful for it. I tell you what, there's so many people that's out there, and they're hurting in the church, but out of the church. And I guess a lot, Brother Clint, you outdid your own self this time. I'm telling you, that was a classic. I'm telling you, that was a classic. We all need that. And I guess a lot of y'all that are on social media, y'all have seen the little flyer that we've put out here at the church on recovery and beyond. And it's a meeting that we're going to be holding here at the church. And Brother Clint, everything you said today, it's just so synced. It's so synced with everything. It's an outreach. But this meeting that we're going to be having is going to be an outreach. It's not necessarily a church service, but it's for people in the church. If they have some issues, it's all sorts of issues, whether it's anger. People deal with anger and they don't know how to control it. People deal with depression, anxiety, substance abuse of many forms and varieties. And God is the answer to all of that. God is the answer. But you know, there's people that's out there in the world. There's people in the church that deal with these things, but we have God. We have God. But what do the people in the world, when they're dealing with these things, they're dealing with these things, and where is their hope? We've got, as a church, we have got to be the lifeline. We have got to be that hope. And so that's what that meeting is about on Tuesday night, November the 12th at 7 o'clock. The church is welcome to come. It's not going to be like a church service, though, because this is a community outreach. But the reason I'm making this announcement is because this message stirred me so much. I'm asking each and every one of you that's in here, if you're active on social media, please, when you see the flyer, I think it's been posted on the website. I think it's going to be going out up on the sign. This is a community outreach so that we as a church can be that lifeline to those that need it. We've got to reach out to them. We've got to give them a hope that they don't have. We have God. They don't have God. So we've got to be a hope for them. And if you have it, repost it on your page. Get the word out. If there's anybody you know that's struggling, that's going through things, depression or anxiety or substance abuse, people that's wanting help and hope, we want to be that for them. Please get the word out to as many people. And you're welcome to come. I welcome the prayers, because it's prayers that's going to change it. And I love y'all, and I hope I didn't do anything out of order.
Praise God. A lot of people need help. Well, let's remember. This afternoon at 4:30, the young people are going to come together. together for prayer. And I believe it's 13 and up. So make sure that if you fall in that category, in that group, that you're here. Maybe before we leave, why don't you look at somebody and say to them, saints with shovels get in trouble. So why don't you tell each other, say, drop your shovel, pick up your sword. We love you. We appreciate you. We thank you. You're dismissed in Jesus' name.